show Health and Wellness Myths vs. Facts. I'm Gargi Rawat. Healthy women make a healthy world is a popular statement, but do women truly pay attention to their health because of their multiple responsibilities? Women are often preoccupied with their spouses or children's health while neglecting their own. Women's health differs from that of men in numerous ways. Although women in advanced nations have closed the gender gap in life expectancy and now live longer than men, they still suffer from disease early with significant mortality outcomes in many areas of health. Women's health is determined not just by their biology, but also by situations such as poverty, job security, and family support. Now, in recent years, there has been a significant surge in the concerns about women's health. The recent lifestyle modifications of today's women have been attributed to an upsurge in diseases. The prevalence of metabolic disorders is increasing in women. The need of the hour is to adopt the easiest strategy of prevention, and prevention means an early diagnosis and timely and effective treatment. But we have with us today an expert panel to discuss these concerns of around women's health. Thank you so much, doctor, for joining us. We're joined by Dr. Fulrenu Chauhan, Section Coordinator, Department of Endocrinology at PD Hinduja Hospital, NMRC, Mumbai, and Dr. Ashwini Joshi, Consultant Diabetologist, Director, Joshi Diabetes Center in Pune. Thank you again, doctors, for joining us. And Dr. Chauhan, I'd like to start with you talking about women's health. And women are prone to various hormonal disorders. Why are hormonal abnormalities more common in women, and what are the most prevalent hormonal disorders in women?
Hi, good afternoon. I'm really glad for this question. And as you correctly said, most of the times women tend to ignore or neglect their health. And as a result of which, with the type of changes which are happening in the world together, women are probably more badly affected than men are. To answer the second question first, autoimmune disorders are commonly seen in women at large, anywhere in the world and all ages. And here it would be the thyroid disorders, which are very, very common, hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism. Diabetes is probably seen equally, a little more probably in men before the age of 50. But once a woman attains menopause, there's an exponential increase in the incidence of diabetes in women and the associated complications. Osteoporosis is also very, very common in women from a very early age, though it's recognized or picked up much later on. And complications such as fractures, especially vertebral fractures, are very common in women. Now, why is it that this happens in women? It's probably because women don't look after themselves. They suffer from lifestyle changes with hardships, from depression, all of which causes an increase in certain hormones, causing in hormones in imbalance, which probably affects the immune system and cross-reacts with our own body proteins. Hence, women obviously have a higher incidence of all these illnesses.
All right, and it's important to be aware, so you can guard yourself against it or manage them better. And I think that awareness is increasing, but it needs to be a lot more. Dr. Joshi, diabetes can affect people of any age, race, or sex, and it can affect people with any lifestyle. Are the risk factors of diabetes different in women than men?
Right. Now, what happens in India, as you rightly mentioned, women's health, their own health, is not their top priority. Their priority becomes their family, their work, and hence the typical risk factors may be wrong nutrition or maybe sedentary lifestyle or lot of stress at their domestic place or at workplace with a strong family history puts, of course, women also at risk of developing this type 2 diabetes. The problem with women is they will come for help at a very later stage. Because health is not their priority, they will not seek the help unless they find a particular disturbing symptom which is lingering on. Only then they approach the healthcare. So even though the risk factors are same for men and women, we see more number of men suffering from diabetes because maybe they are coming to the healthcare pretty early in the phase of disease as against women who would present very late. So prioritization is something which does affect the incidence of diabetes in women, and that is a very critical role what impacts their incidence of diabetes.
All right. Dr. Chauhan, some women develop diabetes, since we've been discussing diabetes right now. They develop it when they get pregnant. That happens to some women. And are these women then predisposed to future diabetes? And what care should they take after the baby is delivered?
This is known as gestational diabetes mellitus, and if you define it correctly, it is diabetes which occurs only during pregnancy and then it disappears. Now, just as there are certain risk factors which are established for to identify those patients or those women who are going to develop type 2 diabetes, we have similar risk factors who will develop this GDM. So if there's a family history of diabetes, if there is obesity, if there is sedentary lifestyle, if there are other metabolic problems such as hypertension, cholesterol, early heart disease, these are the women who have to be aware that they may develop diabetes during pregnancy. Very, very important to, you know, nowadays in metro cities, we have preconception counseling. I think at the time of preconception counseling, it's very important to talk to them about postpartum counseling and lifestyle changes which happen immediately after the delivery. So typically in our country, the culture allows the woman to be fattened to have a better baby, a healthy baby. And mothers, in-laws, grandparents, etc., they prepare foods which are so rich in calories and fat that automatically these women develop this borderline diabetes or other metabolic risks. Postpartum or following the delivery of the child, one has to emphasize that these kind of foods should not be advocated. They have to go back onto normal diet or slightly low calorie diet. They have to start walking, not exercising per se, and do everything that they were doing earlier before the pregnancy happened. Also, if they have gestational diabetes during the first pregnancy, there's a strong possibility that they might develop again during subsequent pregnancies. So they have to be told about that. And after about 6 to 8 weeks after the delivery of the baby, they have to do an oral glucose tolerance test, a fasting and a post-lunch blood sugar along with HbA1c to check whether the diabetes is persistent or was it only GDM. That's very, very important.
All right, to do that follow-up, and also very important that you pointed out, we have to get out of this mentality of eating for two when you're pregnant, or, you know, letting the woman just eat anything. In fact, if you want to care for her health, give her the most healthy food there is. Dr. Joshi, major congenital malformations remain the leading cause of mortality and serious morbidity in infants of mothers with type 1 and type 2 diabetes. What care should women with diabetes take before planning a pregnancy?
Right. So as we talked just now regarding gestational diabetes, which comes when pregnancy is first conceived and then diabetes happens, that is a gestational diabetes. But there are so many women who are already suffering from, say, type 1 diabetes, where they need insulin as a treatment, and so many women who are suffering from type 2 diabetes and eventually they want to conceive or they conceive. So this is known as pre-gestational diabetes. Now, we have to keep a normal blood glucose level during the conception time. Why this is important? Because normal blood glucose level leads to a healthy ovum. A healthy ovum will lead to a very healthy embryo, and then the risk of malformations will reduce drastically. If this is not done, then if we leave the sugar high and then conception happens, there is a very high chance of the baby getting cardiac problems, or there is a preterm pregnancy, or there is a stillbirth, there is a large baby, so on and so forth. So there is a risk to the mother as well as to the child. Hence, pregnancy planning is of utmost importance, where the doctor will control the sugar level for at least 6 months for the ovum to be healthy. We will target the HbA1c to be less than 6.5. Also, during pregnancy, the drugs change. Patients are not allowed to take the same tablets as they were taking earlier on. They will be shifted to insulin. Maybe somebody who is a type 1 diabetes already on insulin, the dose will be intensified, or they will be put on something called as insulin pumps. So to plan all these things, a preconception counseling, getting on to the target is extremely important. Along with that, thyroid function test is something which is very important, which needs to be done always in pregnant women.
All right, now we've been talking about diabetes, but let's not talk about heart health and women. And this is something that I think the awareness has increased over the last couple of years, but still people don't know enough about this. So Dr. Chauhan, you know, we discussed that women can suffer from various hormonal disorders. What are the female specific disorders that increase a woman's risk of heart disease?
As I said, that the sedentary lifestyle, the eating pattern, the central obesity, which they invariably develop because of lack of exercise, working very, very hard at home but not exercising enough, not taking care of themselves, are situations wherein women invariably add to the burden of heart disease. Also, once a woman crosses into menopause, the estrogen is a hormone which protects a woman from several thrombotic episodes, heart disease, paralysis, so on and so forth. Once they cross over, and in addition, if they have metabolic risks, they're surely going to develop some form of problems in the heart or paralysis or in the lower limb arteries. So that is the way that they have to be educated first and foremost. They have to undergo regular checkups. And once something is detected, instead of saying, baad mein karenge, inko dekhenge, wo dekhenge, we have to take instant action. Education is very, very important for women, especially in the rural as well as in certain urban cities, that care has to be taken once they cross over into menopause. What about certain women-specific disorders, even when seen during adolescence? Like, we all know that there is something known as PCOS, or polycystic ovarian syndrome. Though it happens in adolescence, if one does not take care, it gradually converts into type 2 diabetes and metabolic syndrome. These same girls are at as much risk of developing heart disease as women with type 2 diabetes. Gestational diabetes, about which I spoke some time back, also at a risk of developing heart disease at an earlier age compared to those who do not have diabetes at a younger age.
All right, so these are important things to watch out for. Now, Dr. Joshi, is it true that females with diabetes often have more serious complications and greater risk of death than males?
Yeah. So, women, as I mentioned, health is not their priority. So, whatever symptoms they will get, they will try to neglect. And hence, when the symptom gets advanced, that is the point when they come to the healthcare. Therefore, we get to see complications more often in women, especially if there is a lot of burning in the feet, they will ignore it until there is a wound which has actually happened secondary to diabetes. The wound gets infected, then they will land up to the clinics. But men will approach earlier. So, especially women will delay their presentation to any kind of healthcare system and ignore themselves. So that needs to be avoided, and hence preventive checkups, getting their health checks done at appropriate ages, maybe at the age of 35 nowadays, those who have a higher family history or they are sedentary or they are stressed up, that is the time when it is always advisable to undergo certain at least basic investigations, so we will be able to treat them on time and prevent the complications.
All right, so again and again, it all boils down to, you know, going for those regular checkups and preempting any sort of a disease, any sort of serious risk to our health. We'll slip into a short break now and come back with more questions for you, doctors. Welcome back. You're watching Health and Wellness, Myths versus Fact, and we're focusing on women's health today. And joining us are doctors to answer all our questions. And Dr. Chauhan, hormonal cycles can affect women's cardiovascular health. Estrogen is protective of the heart, as estrogen relaxes the arteries and promotes good cholesterol. Will estrogen replacement therapy then help reduce the risk of heart attacks?
While this is an obvious explanation that if you have estrogen, then you're protected from any kind of heart disease. But once a woman attains menopause, we actually do not advocate hormone replacement therapy in terms of giving estrogen, because the ill effects or side effects of estrogen therapy after menopause are far more than the beneficial effects. And frankly, if there is a propensity or a possibility of one developing a heart disease, then there are other medical treatments as well as other form of treatment available, which are far, far better. They work more easily and acutely prevent another episode. Now, if at all, if you need to use estrogen therapy in women after menopause, we can give it under strict supervision for a short period of time, provided a woman is less than 60 years of age and menopause had occurred about 10 years back. Otherwise, giving HRT can actually increase the risk of heart disease after the age of 60, because estrogen itself causes some degree of dyslipidemia or abnormal lipid profile. It thickens the blood. It increases the incidence of thrombotic phenomena, especially deep vein thrombosis, heart attacks, or paralytic effects. So one need not give or should not give estrogen after menopause. Those women who've undergone premature menopause, means menopause due to some medical condition or surgical condition before the age of, say, 40, definitely should be given estrogen therapy under strict supervision. And the safest estrogens are the natural estrogens, which are easily available, and not the synthetic estrogen therapy.
All right. So important, to know this about the estrogen therapy, as it remains something that, Dr. Clearly, you question. Now, Dr. Joshi, oral contraceptives are some of the most effective birth control methods, but does taking birth control raise the risk of developing heart disease?
Yes, oral contraceptive pills are the most important method of birth control, and the benefit of it is definitely more. But if it is taken in an unsupervised manner and for a longer duration, it does lead to thrombosis of the arteries, of the veins especially. It can cause deep vein thrombosis or venous sinus thrombosis. So oral contraceptive pills, especially the older generation ones, do come with a higher risk. So we have to, the ladies have to take those under supervision always. Now, the synthetic estrogen progesterone combinations are relatively safer, but yes, the combination does have an impact on the thrombotic tendency which it triggers. And benefit, as I said, especially is extremely important as far as birth control is concerned. Now, women who have hypertension or women with age more than 35 years have to be more careful when they are taking such type of combination pills. Also, nowadays, we get to see lot of young girls getting habituated to smoking. And smoking is a big risk factor for developing a heart problem or arterial thrombosis, even stroke. So combination pills on top of these bad habits becomes a very risky kind of a behavior pattern. And of course, to prevent these problems, the pills have to be taken only under doctor's supervision.
All right, it's important to keep all this in mind when, on the pill. Dr. Chauhana, diabetes affects almost every organ and system of the body. It also affects mental health. So is it true that the risk of depression increases in women with diabetes?
There's a definite correlation between hyperglycemia, high blood sugar, and diabetes. And also there's an indirect correlation or cause, which are really multiple. So coming to the first part, where hyperglycemia, high blood sugar definitely interacts with a lot of systems, neurotransmitters, chemical agents in the blood, hormones such as cortisol, catecholamines. And that, as it increases because of the high blood sugar, that increases the incidence of depression, especially as we know as endogenous depression. This is where the apparent cause of depression is not known. Also, the burden of diabetes is such, and it is not single. It's a lifelong disorder. You have to live with taking care of what to eat, to exercise, to keep everything under control, to poke yourself, to go to the labs. And in association, as the disease age increases, you have the complications of diabetes. Imagine if you have an amputated foot or a diabetic neuropathy, you have a retinopathy where your vision is affected, you have a kidney problem where you have to undergo dialysis, and it's a huge financial burden on the family. I think diabetes per se is something that we can do without, and it can cause a lot of stress to the patient and the entire family.
All right. And Dr. Ashwini, it said that most of the people don't feel chest pain during a heart attack. And is this more with women? And do men and women then experience the same symptoms associated with heart attacks?
Right. So what happens with diabetes is basically it starts disturbing our blood vessels. I always give a simile. If the blood becomes thicker, like a sugary syrup, it is not very viscous or fluid. It is a thick fluid and it starts clogging our blood vessels. And if we leave it uncontrolled, then more so the risk of heart attack increases. What happens in diabetes because of the neuropathy which is developed, typically the patient may not experience the chest pain or a crushing type of a pain of heart attack. Now, this all, as it is, the symptom is not typical. The presentation is maybe like breathlessness or lot of dyspepsia or acidity, what we call as, or there may be a back pain or a jaw pain. So that itself puts the patients in a confusion whether they are really suffering from a heart problem. When it comes to females, their pain threshold is already high. They will linger around this symptom and ignore it. They will label it to some abnormal or stale food which they would have consumed a day prior, or breathlessness, they will just let it pass by and will not reach to the healthcare system early. So these atypical symptoms should be kept in mind, and the easiest way out is any diabetic lady who gets any such kind of a symptom of breathlessness, acidity, back pain, jaw pain, dear ladies, it is safe to go to a nearby clinic, get one ECG done. It does not cost much, but just rule out that there is no heart attack which is impending. Neither it is angina or a big heart attack. So just confirm that. And if by chance it is noted, it is always safe or wise to get treated immediately, because for heart muscle, time is muscle. So we have to treat on time to save the cardiac function. So the atypical symptoms should never be ignored, and just get one ECG done and be sorted.
All right. So very, very important, you know, advice for women and for managing of health. And again, I'd like to emphasize the important message from the doctors is to go for those checkups regularly. Don't neglect your health. It's much better to preempt any sort of crisis to your health. Thank you so much, doctors, for taking your time out and answering all those questions.